really need to get to the main event. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't know where you were on the evening of Wednesday, the 19th of July, 2017, at 10 to 6. But funnily enough, I know exactly where I was. I was in my office in Parliament watching a compelling speech, a new maiden speech by the newly elected member for Saffron Walden. Now, 2 weeks prior to that, I'd done my own maiden speech, 10 minutes, no notes, plenty of jokes. I thought I'd nailed it, or at least survived. But KEMI had no intention of just surviving. She turned up with a plan. And once she'd got through the social niceties that go with making a maiden speech, she settled into the rhythm of making a compelling case for effective government. She cited the often quoted John Bright, who was supposed to have said that the House of Commons is the mother of all parliaments. But what he actually said in a speech in Birmingham in 1865, and I throw that in because I'm a proud Brummie, what he actually said was that this country was the mother of parliaments. This great country had given opportunity to a 16-year-old girl newly arrived from Nigeria to work her way up through sheer natural ability and determination to become an MP. Now, I had the opportunity over the following 5 years to see at very close quarters how she developed those skills that had been on display in Parliament on that Wednesday evening. Gathering ministerial experience along the way, she was in the Treasury. More recently, she was in the Department for Levelling Up with me, where I was privileged to serve with her. I've seen her become a black belt in political combat, taking on all comers from all parties in the chamber and leaving them visibly diminished as a result of that encounter. She's brave to the point of being fearless because of the strong convictions that she holds. But she's also funny and charming and caring and occasionally vulnerable, as evidenced by her fear of seagulls that I saw for myself, weirdly, on the terrace of the House of Commons one evening. But anyway, that all explains why I'm proud to be supporting her. But why should you be supporting her? Well, looking around the audience, you look like a politically savvy bunch to me. So I'm imagining that you've all read the article from the Times at the weekend, and you all know that this isn't a leadership campaign, just touting various political policies to appeal to one wing of the party or another. This is a woman with vision, a woman determined to level with the British public and explain exactly what this government can do. A smaller government, but a more effective one. And as somebody I respect tremendously recently said, governing is hard, leading is difficult, reform takes guts. But imagine just how much greater our already great country could be if we had a Prime Minister who could deliver all three. Ladies and gentlemen, KEMI Badenoch.
Too long, politicians have been telling us that we can have it all, that you can have your cake and eat it, and I'm here to tell you that that isn't true. It never has been. There are always tough choices in life and in politics. No free lunches, no tax cuts without limits on government spending, no stronger defence without a slimmer state. Governing involves trade-offs, and we need to start being honest about that. Unlike others, I'm not going to promise you things without a plan to deliver them. People are sick of that. They're crying out for honesty. Today, I want to be honest about our economic challenge. The scale of the challenge we face means we can't run away from the truth. Inflation has made the cost of living crisis acute, but the problems go back way further. We've had a poor decade for living standards. We have overburdened our economy. There is too much unproductive public spending, consuming taxpayers' hard-earned money, and there are too many well-meaning regulations slowing growth and clogging up the arteries of the economy. Too many policies, like the net zero target, set up with no thought to the effect on industries in the poorer parts of this country. The consequence is simply to displace emissions to other countries. Unilateral economic disarmament. And that is why we need change. And that is why I'm running to be leader. To be a prime minister who tells the truth, because the truth will set us free. The problems run deep, and I'm in no doubt about the scale of the challenge any new prime minister will have to deal with. The underlying economic problems we face have been exacerbated by COVID and by war. But what makes the situation worse is that the answers to our problems, conservative answers, haven't been articulated or delivered in a way appropriate to the modern age. We have been in the grip of an underlying economic, social, cultural, and intellectual malaise. The right has lost its confidence and courage. Our ability to defend the free market as the fairest way of helping people prosper has been undermined. It has been undermined by a willingness to embrace protectionism for special interests. It's been undermined by retreating in the face of the Ben and Jerry's tendency, those who say a business's main priority is social justice, not productivity and profit. And it's been undermined by the actions of crony capitalists who collude with big bureaucracy to rig the system in favor of incumbents against entrepreneurs. The truth that limited government, doing less but better, is the best way to restore faith in government has been forgotten, as we've pandered to pressure groups and caved in to every campaigner with a moving message. And that has made the government agenda into a shopping list of disconnected, unworkable, and unsustainable policies. The knowledge that the nation state, our democratic nation state, is the best way for people to live in harmony and enjoy prosperity has been overridden by the noisy demands of those who want to delegitimize, decolonize, and denigrate. And if we don't stand up for our shared institutions, for free speech, due process, and the rule of law, then we end up with a zero-sum game of identity politics which only increases divisions when we need to come together. So free markets, limited government, a strong nation state, those are the conservative principles we need to beat back protectionism, populism, and polarization, and to prepare us for the challenges ahead to win for our country. If I were Prime Minister, I would be driven by these conservative principles to deliver a fairer, freer, wealthier, and united Britain. It's those conservative principles and a belief in facing facts, however uncomfortable, with unflinching honesty, that will guide my approach to government and how we put things right. So, how are we going to do this? I'm an engineer, a systems thinker, a problem solver. In engineering, you can't overcome resistance with rhetoric. You can't get the machine to work with promises. You need to analyze the issue deeply, untangle the mess others have made, and methodically put things right. In the debate we've been having about the future of our party and our country, there have been lots of promises to cut taxes, and I can understand why. With economic growth faltering and the highest tax burden in decades, it is right that we ask how we reduce taxes on businesses, families, and individuals. And I am committed to reducing corporate and personal taxes, but I will not enter into a tax bidding war over my tax cuts are bigger than yours. To make promises that you cannot keep is a betrayal of everything that I stand for. I really want to stress that the dividing line in this race is not tax cuts, it's judgment. We can only deliver lower taxes if we stop pretending that the state continues to do everything we are currently trying to do. We need to recognize it is not just a matter of doing the same with less. We need to focus on the essentials. We need to be straight with people. The idea we can simply say efficiency savings, click our heels three times and they will materialize, it's for the birds. It is the scale and structure of government that drives the inefficiencies. My government will discard the priorities of Twitter and focus on the people's priorities. When we can't deliver passports and driving licenses on time, why are we spending millions on people whose jobs literally didn't exist a decade ago, like staff well-being coordinators in the public sector? What about the well-being of the actual public who can't go on holiday because we can't process a piece of paper in time? We are now taxing and spending more on government than we have ever done, and yet people's satisfaction with the quality of their day-to-day services is falling. This is not sustainable. We can't carry on subsidizing so many young people onto university courses, which leave them with debts and diminished job prospects. We must require schools to concentrate on effective whole class teaching of rigorous subjects rather than allocating tight resources to superfluous support staff and peripheral activities. We should get the police to focus on neighborhood crime, not waste time and resources worrying about hurt feelings online. Reducing what government tries to do, we not only reduce the cost of government, we focus government on the people's priorities, we allow the space for individuals, employers and entrepreneurs to solve problems. And only then do we create the opportunity to cut taxes.
Yes.
We can reduce the amount we spend on international aid while still remaining a force for good in the world. We can ensure an efficient civil service, but let's be clear, simply getting rid of diversity and equality officers is not going to move the dial. It's not good enough to just promise a bonfire of quangos. Every single quango leader should be accountable and sackable by a democratic minister. We can create proper accountability around the £100 billion in grant, which government currently dispenses. Every household in the country, especially during this current cost of living crisis, thinks about value for money with every pound of the earned wages that they spend. Government doesn't do that with people's hard-earned taxes. While the priority of the £300 billion the government spends on procurement should be value for money, in truth, this is being undermined by tick-box exercises in sustainability, diversity, and equality. These are good things, but they need to be done properly, and we mustn't move away from the core mission. Now, I recognize that this is an ambitious agenda. I'm running to be Prime Minister when you're a 42-year-old is by definition ambitious. But I am ambitious, but for our country and for our party. I chose to become a Conservative MP to serve, and I chose this country because here I could breathe free and I could be everything that I wanted to be. I grew up in Nigeria and I saw firsthand what happens when politicians are in it for themselves, when they use public money as their private piggy banks, when they promise the earth and pollute not just the air, but the whole political atmosphere with their failure to serve others. I saw what socialism means for millions. It's poverty and broken dreams. I came to Britain determined to make my way in a country where hard work and honest endeavor can take you anywhere. I paid my way through college, working in McDonald's, flipping burgers, cleaning loos, and I learned firsthand that earning your own money rather than relying on others gives you not just more freedom, but more dignity. I am so grateful to so many people who took a chance on me and helped me succeed. But I also remember that throughout my life, there have been people who said, you can't, you shouldn't, this is not for you. And in politics, many people who said, you're in the wrong party, you're saying the wrong things, you can't do that. But I'm not the sort of person who you can sideline, silence, or cancel. I tell the truth, I fight for change, I stand up for people, and I stand up for the causes and the country I love. Some might say this is no time for novices. I think this is no time for steady as it goes sinking into decline. It's time for change. To win the next election and deliver Conservative solutions to the challenges of today, the Conservative Party must stand as the party for change. I have the conviction, the courage, and the clarity of thought to deliver that change. for the people of this country. Thank you. I have a very enthusiastic support group. Thank you. And now on to questions. And I think I have a question from Nick from the BBC. Nick?
Thank you. KEMI Badenoch, Nick Watt from BBC Newsnight. Anyone who knows you knows that you always speak your mind. But I'm wondering how that would work if you become Prime Minister. And if there's a choice between achieving unity in your divided party or pursuing your convictions, what comes first, unity or conviction?
I don't agree with the premise of your question, Nick. I think you can do both. People need to know that what you're saying is true. Without that, you will never get any unity. And perhaps if we'd been honest with each other a lot longer ago, we might be more united than we are now. Perhaps if, for instance, we hadn't made promises to each other, even within our party, about various things that we wanted to do, which some members then didn't see happening, there would be a little bit more trust and then a bit more unity. So I think you have to start from first principles. If people can't believe what you are saying, if they don't know that you're going to do what you say you're going to do, then why should they vote for you? So conviction creates unity. And then from GB News, Darren McCaffrey. I think my approach is to focus on how we can present ourselves as a party of government. I never start by attacking Labour. We are in government and we need to continue to demonstrate competence, but also we need to show that we are a party that listens to the public. For the last few months, we've spent a lot of time talking about ourselves, which I think has been really unhealthy. We need to talk about people's priorities. At the moment, that's cost of living, it's education, it's crime, it's health and social care, it's those bread and butter issues. I do think that Conservatives have the right policies and we need to articulate them better, especially when we have difficult decisions to make. But what I would say to people who are considering voting Labour is that almost everything that we have done that they didn't like, Labour wanted us to do more of it and go faster and harder. Shihab Khan from ITV.
Kevin, Dominic Raab, the Deputy Prime Minister, and Grant Shapps have come out in support of Rishi Sunak whilst you've been talking. Liz Truss has got the support of Jacob Rees-Mogg and Nadine Dorries. There seems to be significant momentum behind the two of those, both of whom have served in senior positions within the Cabinet. How do you differentiate yourself and take those two campaigns on, given that there's so much momentum behind the both?
So I have a lot of respect for Rishi Sunak and Liz Truss. I was a junior minister to both of them in the Treasury and inequalities, but I feel that there needs to be a genuine debate in our party before we select the leader. We shouldn't just assume that it's a continuation of what we've had before, but with different personalities. So I do think I am a differentiator, because I do think that I talk a little bit more about what the state is doing wrong. I think we sometimes get overly defensive as a government and don't want to stop doing certain things because it looks like they are U-turns. I think sometimes we worry about changing our minds if things aren't working. I'm prepared to actually look at many of the activities that government is carrying out which don't necessarily need to be, which the state, in fact, I should say, rather than government, which don't necessarily need to be done. I think that is a differentiator. I think that I differentiated myself from both of them on lots of social issues when I was speaking in my equalities brief, and I have something to say that I think the party and the public want to hear. Yeah. So I'm in this to win it. I'm not worried about Rishi, I'm not worried about Liz or any of the other candidates. I want you to hear the message that I'm giving. Jonathan Riley from The Sun.
You talk about not having a free lunch, but many Sun readers will be concerned about paying their heating bills in the winter, buying groceries that are affordable. If you became Prime Minister on September the 5th, what would you do in the short term to tackle the cost of living crisis?
So the cost of living crisis is the big thing that we are dealing with, and inflation is what's driving it and likely to make things worse. So tackling inflation, that's what government should be doing. We need to get it under control, because if we don't, things could still get a lot worse. And I think that if we focus on the things that government should be doing, that only government can do, we will make things easier for people, both in the short, medium and long term. What I'm not going to do is come out with lots of micro-policies about giving people £50 cash here or a rebate there. I think it's very inefficient. There is a lot of dead weight in how we run government. I have people in my constituency telling me that they don't need the winter fuel payments that we give them because they can afford it. Why do we not have a more sophisticated mechanism for means testing? Those are the sort of long-term things which government should be doing, which we haven't been doing, because we're focusing always on the short term, on the news headlines for tomorrow. So what I'm not going to do is give headlines for tomorrow. I'm talking about system change. And finally, Katie Balls from Spectator. I say you're wrong, and you don't know me. It is true that I haven't been in cabinet. That's because nobody put me there. I think if they had, they would have seen me do exactly what I've done with every single job in government that I've been given. And it just so happens that every time I've been a minister, I've done two ministerial roles. I was Children and Families Minister, and also, because they forgot to appoint an Apprenticeships Minister, I did that while 8 months pregnant, and nobody noticed that there was a minister missing. I was in the Treasury and Equalities. I've done Communities and Integration, Local Government, Faith. I have been in multiple departments, and I have seen so much that I think can be changed. But my not being in Cabinet now is actually a huge advantage. Because it means that I don't have the baggage of so many of the decisions that's been made. If people want a fresh face, then they can't have somebody who has been in cabinet a very long time. And there is more to being in cabinet than just sitting around a table. It's not where you've been sitting, it's what you've been doing with the responsibility that's been given to you. And that's what I've shown. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, everybody.
Conservative membership have actually voted. So what's the state of the race? Sky News has teamed up with YouGov to find out. And here it is. On the basis of this, Liz Truss will be heading into Downing Street on September the 6th. She has a commanding lead. 66% say that they would vote for her. 34% say they would vote for Rishi Sunak. Now, that's actually a slight tightening on a couple of weeks ago, but nothing like on the scale that Rishi Sunak would need to overtake Liz Truss in this contest. Let's look at what's happening underneath the bonnet. And those people who have already voted, which is about 6 in 10, 31% say they voted for Rishi Sunak, 68% say they voted for Liz Truss. So even bigger lead there for Liz Truss. What about people that haven't? Does Rishi Sunak have a chance? Well, he, amongst people who haven't yet voted, 29% say that they voted for him, 44% say they voted for Liz Truss. But look at this, 26% say they don't know. That needs over half of these people to go to Rishi Sunak's corner in order for him to have any kind of chance. The numbers just are so difficult at this stage. But what are the challenges that whoever takes over will face? This poll gave us some clues. The affection that this party has, the Conservative Party, for Boris Johnson, evident in this. We asked, what if Boris Johnson was actually on the ballot paper and he wins by a landslide? 46% say they'd vote for him, 24% for Liz Truss, 23% for Rishi Sunak. This group of people, the Conservative Party, quite clear, they don't think Boris Johnson should have been slung out of number 10 at all in this poll. But what of the toxicity of this race? Lots of mudslinging. But has it rebounded on the membership? Well, the answer appears yes for a big minority. We asked whether Liz Truss should include Rishi Sunak in her cabinet. 52% say yes. But look at this. Over a third of the Conservative Party say that the man that took the Conservative Party and the government and the country through the pandemic and wanted to be Prime Minister should be left out of the next Prime Minister's cabinet. That's quite a degree of dislike, of hatred.
Great honour to be with President Kagame. We have had tremendous discussions on Rwanda. The job they've done is absolutely terrific. We have trade with Rwanda and just general, I would say, great relationships. I want to congratulate you, Mr. President, as being the new head of the African Union. That's a great honor. This was just announced recently, and that really, truly is a great honor. So please give my regards. I know you're going to your first meeting very shortly. And please give my warmest regards. But it's an honor to have you as a friend. Thank you. Thank you very much.
Well, it was a great honor to meet the President of the United States, President Donald Trump. And we had good discussions on those two levels, the bilateral relations between Rwanda and the United States. Rwanda has benefited tremendously from the support of the United States in many areas where it is in peace support operations we have carried out in different parts of the world. We had the United States on our side supporting us. They have supported our economy in trade, investment. We see a lot of tourists from United States, visitors coming to Rwanda, and President, I wanted to thank you for the support we have received from you personally and the administration, and we are looking forward to also working with the United States at the level of the African Union, where we are carrying out reforms at the African Union so that we get our act together to do the right things. And that helps in cooperating with the United States. It would be more beneficial when we are organized to know what we want from the United States.
Sure.
For that cooperation. So I thank you very much.
Well, I thank you very much. And it's a great honor to have all of you here. And we'll speak for a little bit longer. And thank you very much. Thank you for
The U.S., when they borrow money, they're getting it at 1.5, 1.9 interest rate. Africans, when they get the same amount of money, they're paying 9, 10%. The people who don't need a break, they get a break. The ones who need a break, they don't get a break. The sheer survival of the World Bank, IMF, is based on the fact that African countries and many other developing countries do not succeed. Their success is based on our failure. That has to change. And guess who can make that change? We, the children of Africa. We, the Africans, are the ones who have to say, we know your game now. Enough is enough. We're not playing it anymore. And this is where the diaspora come in. There are more Ghanaian doctors in New York City than in the entire country of Ghana. There are more Nigerian doctors in LA than in the entire country of Nigeria. So let's be serious here. What Africa needs is capacity, capacity, capacity. And that capacity is in the diaspora. So it behooves us to bring the diaspora together. Let them understand what is really going on in our Africa. Diaspora are not going home. Diaspora are angry about Africa because they are not understanding the root cause of why Africa is where it is today. They think getting rid of a president will take care of the problem. Far from it. That president is just going to be replaced by another one who's going to equally suffer from the same difficult environment to work in. So let's look at an Africa that must be free to take care of herself, an Africa that's free from exploitation from outsiders. The multinationals who are stealing from Africa every day in broad daylight. I use an example of the DRC. If you ever fly very low over the DRC, you'll see tarmacs in the jungle. You'll see 747s flying into DRC, picking up minerals and flying right out. The same multinationals are responsible for arming young people and giving them MK-16s. Because why? Their satellites in the skies are telling them where that village is. There are lots of diamonds. So what do? Arm young people, drag them up, and send them to go chop off a few heads. The rest of the village runs away so they come behind and do their illegal mining. We black people must understand what is really going on. Because what we are shown instead is, oh, look at those Africans killing each other. There are some serious games that have been played in Africa for far too long. And once we understand that, we can strategize as to how we can begin to bring the difference and bring the change that Africa needs. And that change can only come if the African diaspora are united and the Wakanda villages, as I call them. It is our organized way of saying, starting with one African diaspora center of excellence, it will be a new city, a developmental hub that we can then take from there. Every sector is developed. Take healthcare. How many doctors do we need in this region to take care of this many people? We pick up education, same thing. We pick up engineering. We pick up electricity. How many megawatts of power do we have in the region? How many do we need? Be it solar, be it wind, be it hydro, be it geothermal, be it nuclear.
$1, one CD. In the time of Mills and Mahama, two CDs, $1. If I was them, I would say to the people of Ghana, I'm sorry. We are sorry for the poor work we have done. We're going to go and think about ourselves. But that is not the people we're dealing with. The fruits of office, the money, the money under the table has become sweet for them, so they're determined to stay. Are we going to allow that to happen? Are we going to allow that to happen? In Kufuor's time, one of the people who advised and helped him develop a strong CD was my running mate, Muhammadu Bawumia. Then he was deputy governor of the Bank of Ghana. It's one of the reasons I brought him to come and join me, that we will work on the CD and create again a strong CD that will be able to allow us to develop our economy and allow our traders and our work to be able to develop. We have told the world, that under our leadership, we're going to turn our back on the old economy, the raw material exporting economy, and build a new industrial value-adding economy in our country that will bring jobs for our people and for especially for the young people of our country. That is the goal of the new NPP government and the administration of the National Government. A competitive labor force, because we're going to give all the children of our country an opportunity.
When you were singing,
the masters of the field were coming, we Warren boys are coming, the masters of the field are coming, we Warren boys are coming, to win the race, we trust in God, to win the race.
And that's for Opokuwari.
Masters are coming. Masters are coming. Mm-hmm. Masters are coming to win the race. Oh, masters are coming. And then they will sing. Then we go more. Then we will keep quiet. Mm-hmm. Then they will sing. When they tire, then we will come in. Mm-hmm. Diplo Warrens are in the game. We have to win the race and take a cup. We are the masters of the field and best athletes, famous to all and decent boys, how deployed. Then they will start. I'm going to go ahead and say,
Hello, Obusia 4, Kofi Kurantini, Nane, Ilevi, 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 Kasana, Yakasagana, Ubiarekan, Ilevi, Inti, Sese, Miti, Bing, Me, Ni, Ilevi. Because Ilevi problem, no, e simple. Na Ghana government is on Peser, Otiase, Inti, Neye, Betrema, Chren, no, Watiasi, Ye, Obusia 4, 2020, IMF, Ma Ghana, $1 billion, billion with a B. Same year, no, World Bank ma Ghana, $430 million. Nina for COVID. Every year, you know, in 2021, no, IMF for some ma Ghana, $1 billion bill. $1 billion with a B. Na World Bank some ma Ghana, $130 million. In 2021, no, so 1 billion, 130 million, yeah, if he World Bank buy any IMF buy, no. Now we say post COVID rejuvenation program, say, what be my young economy, no, so, into no, World Bank, the IMF, this is kind of my Ghana. Ghana government call Bank of Ghana, koyi 20 billion cedis, say, COVID in T. Nebushianfo, World Bank come on with 2 billion. IMF amamu 2 billion. World Bank amamu $560 million for COVID. I know an sum. Musan call Bank of Ghana kuyi 20 billion cedis. Say COVID in ti. Say si kanu wo mu hun konta nchire yenge. Ana wembu. Wo mu ye. Bebi ya wo befa wo Ghana. E-levy tax. Woko ports are e-levy. Woko airport. Woko hotels. Be, what they are to be biara so Ghana, e-levy, e-levy, e-levy. Sesi kana hena afa, petrol, e-levy. Uko union ma port, e-levy. Sesi kana hena afa na. Inti se ne, government peso ochre yeng se, Ghana fu ebi a yadjune ne nye jumenti na ode sa e-levy nereba. Yansu ye pesi echre government se, enye se yadjune nye jumo yehu ne kosono ni ejai amano. If you say, whoop, say, wunya, e levy, young, ye, ye, responsible citizens, yam, per se, ye, 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 stand by, yet, jina hoke ka, ye, train fire, or no, okay, say, yes, ye, responsible citizens, right? Into ye, responsible citizens. Nana tinne say, so whoop, per se, would frisika, na would ye bribia, because young credit rating record former, and ye, young abra bought now the e levy barber to so. Identity, because there is over almost 3 billion Ghana cedis record to the presidency. 3 billion Ghana. Inti te also by 75%. What also by 75%? I will save $375 million. $375 million save and not at the presidency. You don't need 3 billion Ghana cedis going to the presidency. Then now what are you, Mr. Akufo-Addo? And ne koso wo. Presidency, deng na mudi sikani ye presidency ho. Mudi ye deng, mudi shi usuruku, ana deng na mudi ye. Legislature, Ghana legislators, ye wo 275 legislators. Deng na sa legislators no, wo ye ma Ghana. Say say minimum ka say, he, Ghana fwe, ye betumi afa, I install it, Watson, IBM computer, wo friend is Watson no, ye, artificial intelligence are over 90% of young parliamentarians. No, you bet me replace one with Watson computer. Ben Wedjuma na yen downscale. Adeng ye here 275 parliamentarians out. Deng woye magana. One liability to Ghanaians na ye over 100,000 cedis every month per parliamentarian. 100,000 cedis. Kona kubun kunta na he. Enwechi. What judiciary? Judiciary, heh? America, ye 330 million people. 11 times the size of Ghana. Ghana, ye 30.8 million. America wore 9 Supreme Court judges. Akufo-Addo ba na nsinyi. Ghana near wore 10 Supreme Court judges. Akufo-Addo appointed 8 aka ho. Nti say say Ghana a country of less than 31 million people no. Ye wore 18 Supreme Court judges. Deng na how yen 18. Deng na adan yen na chese Kronge wo we are seeing Ghana ne wonti yehia Supreme Court judges. Ding tin ye wo Supreme Court judges. A country of less than 31 million. 18 Supreme Court judges. Ka, one Supreme Court judge biano liability, ebro $150,000, $150,000 a month. Konakobun kuntahe, ne V8s ordered them, ne bodyguards, ne driver, ne krone ba. Then in ti niya fa an extra 8 Supreme Court judges. And on kwancheng, say si a minimum ka say, ye wo 34 ambassadorial post around the world. 34. Vatican City, ewo room kra ye wo ambassador wo ho. Then na ambassador wo Vatican City ye magana. Mun kan chile yenge. Adeng ni ewo ambassadors wo baby to say Malta nom ne wo friend deng Sri Lanka si Sudan nom ni ade deng o common na yen ni ade ba inti ne ewo ambassadors wo Sudan. It doesn't make any kind of sense. Se wo re e-levy. What is this? Yes, I wo 58 diplomatic missions around the world. Diplomatic mission no anka hun fasone se wo trade desk a Eddie income, commerce, bre Ghana. So our diplomatic missions around the world, they year 5080, sika beng wa de bre Ghana. Mun kanchire ye near here. A ye krong waste of money and resource. Muse mu hwe e-levy. Ye betchira mu say e-levy no mun kona mun ko yi infi mu amu futum. Positions na mu create a hun nim fa so no. E ho na mun ko yi infi. Adeng na mu how Ghana for sa MPP for. Deng na Ghana for aye mu nti na de bia ye ntwi ase no. So our positions in now was over 2,000 executive positions. So what were executive benefits and perks? What to kwang wo business class? What nya 4x4? No many are this. How many nurses wo yifi ho? And now what else? So and no be ma 11 no income from 11. You be yifi ho mroso. Then necessary ye catch there a kufu adu ne wo government. So sad no munko yi yifi ho no na mo boka Ghana foka unnecessarily. Na mubwe wye yi ne wye. Na excavators sa unyanku pwa adomi yen se yen sa unko ka. Ni yen nang na ni yen fan ye sika ni yen fan tu yen yi levi kason. Mwabe kache yen se mwakwa shiwe excavators 85. Excavators sa bako ye over 150,000 to 200,000. Mwasa unkwa shiwe naka hon. Na pan wano wehe yezi. Kop no wehe. Ti no wehe ya anom. Kop no so awabwa naka hon. Hey, Akufo-Addo and his government. Why? Ghana fo. Yem penin de empenichina. E levino wana yezubashan wana no wa kwa free scan waza ba. Yem pen. Ine le wakwene. Yen mu ba beku ye be jinamu dine ning se yerem pene. Akufo-Addo and his government. A deng. Wose, when cluelessness meets unpreparedness, no. MPP infoni now be humo ho yabram we're not going to take this, we're not having this monfa yempene ne empenechina 11 ye jia monko enko cut legislature monko cut executive monko cut judiciary na sika ambassadors any wo friend den ambassadorial post any diplomatic missions sanya mani na mon cancel na mon reduce na mon fa computers in your hair legislature say you worth 275 no you bet me the drone I replace one you here 275 at the maximum 4 per region you here 64 parliamentarians you here 211 parliamentarians no where liability to Ghana at about 100,000 cedis every month. Come on, enough of this nonsense.
I want you to win in Krasimbo.
Okay.
So when we are the Krasimbo of knowledge, strength, adaptability, energy, freedom, unity, hope, peacemaking, harmony, intelligence, power of love, strength. Said in class symbols, when you know, obi abra, bobi abi, or boy, yeah, na ne sign, I know a pepper, no, na ye di aka, and in class symbols, you know.
Okay.
Now, Ghana for Tennessee, who said, yeah, and another uncle for the Abu Nemine, ye need your home. And see, this is the Edin class symbol for failure.
What?
It's a free medical. Side in class symbol, who spares him, you know, yeah. I can't in class and boss.
Your president is now a free
Nadeco. Who spells me a new way? I can't in class and boss.
Photo
and a din class and boss for failure.
You are a failure. You are a failure. And I beg you, before we are sick.
Yen and Nanuma Motina see here in class and boss. You see, Mummy and Fawin come.
This photo and in class and boss for
failure. I'm supposed to be here of this.
Now back to the studio.
I'll tell a pastor about this. This is what you want to use your life on.
You don't
know. I am a boy, Wakan.
When?
It is a castle. O man, you hear my.
Hey!
Then nam a memoir and quiet, you know.
Mother,
I come to you.